agreed to replace it within Donner Park, and it will be located right at the corner of Mill Street and Bayview, so right at the very south end of Donner Park. And this will be installed towards the end of July, beginning of August. The second park to report on is Underpass Park. And Underpass Park is, as Meg mentioned, Block 18 here is under construction right now. The park was designed to have three different kind of characters in the space. We call it Block 18, 19, and 20. Block 18 is looking more of a passive space. There's a lot more open air, so it's opportunities for a lot more planting and establishment of a canopy. There'll be a lot more seating there as well. Block 19, which is nearing completion, and same with Block 20. Block 19 is meant to be more kind of a flexible space. There is a playground area for kids, and it looks really, really interesting climbing apparatus. There'll be public art, which I'll show in a few minutes, right in the middle of Block 19. And then Block 20 is the more active zone of basketball courts, also some skateboard apparatus as well. This is a quick kind of shot of Block 20 of the basketball courts that have been installed. So it would be more of a kind of an active zone on the Central Park. Skateboard apparatus, and these are anchored down to the concrete, so for the flexibility over time, you know, place these things. And this is a view many of you might have seen before of the playground in the central block. And again, we're looking at recycled materials for the rubber and recycled content in the concrete as well. There'll be benches and seating, similar to the benches, use of ipe wood for longevity, low maintenance, etc. Another view back, again, one of the climbing apparatus. So you can imagine, again, as Meg mentioned, with TCH here on the north side, urban capital, you have a lot of eyes in the park. You have activity from the Warners spreading into the park as well. Here's just an example of the lighting at nighttime. So the lighting, obviously, one of the considerations is safety. So we have different levels of light. We have up lights that will be at the base of the columns. And also, there's overhead lights, not shown in this one view, because this one view would have a public art right here above. And the constellation of lights will shine up against the public art above. And you can see the river city in the background. So the lighting's LED lights, and they change color, they'll be programmed. There's different possibilities to program at different events, different times of year. And this is the Block 18, which is under construction right now. And what we've done to date is we carved out the site, and now we're bringing back the material back up to the finished grade. And we tagged, which is a term for picking on the trees at the nurseries. They've been tagged, and we hope to have this portion of the park finished by September. Block 19 and 20, our schedules have to open in July for Block 19 and 20 of the park. The public art portion is by Paul Raff Studio. This is not the best kind of image, but you can see the right. It's 57 stainless steel panels that are clamped to the structure above, so meant to reflect activity below, reflect light. Some locations can also reflect and bring in some from water, bring in the sky to a kind of a darker space. This is going to be installed also part of the opening for July for Block 19. So if you can imagine, that would be within this space here, 57 stainless steel panels clamped to the structure. So that's a bit of a summary of the parks. So I'll hand it back to you.
Thank you. As most of you know, River City is a four-phase development that designed by Montreal-based architect Saucy and Perra. Currently, we are under construction in phase one, which you see part of in this image, and then phase two in the front, which is we're in currently in sales. So, Phase one is a two-building phase. There's a tower, 16-story tower here, and a seven-story slab building here. In total, we have 349 units. In both units, we're hoping to occupy in early 2013. So you can see now, right now, this is that seven-story slab building we've recently topped off, so we're starting to install windows and roofing and the exterior cladding. Here we see the portion of the 16-story tower. Right now we're at the ninth floor slab. One of the exciting features of phase one is we have a three-story pedestrian bridge connecting the two buildings. Probably mostly driven because the parking for the entire phase is connected to the seven-story building, so we needed to make a link. The installation of this bridge is scheduled to start next week, so that should be an exciting time. You can see here that seven-story tower and the seven-story podium building and the tower here, and this is roughly where that bridge will be installed. Just a few construction photos. This is a retail space we have on the corner of King and River. It's quite a tall space. It's going to be very public and very glazed to the street, so it'll bring a lot of eyes to the street in this corner. There's a shared rooftop amenity space between phase one and phase two over top of the parking, and on which there'll be a pool. This is just a quick image of that space. You can see how these units here are looking out over top of that image along River Street. We have a townhouses facing River Street. This is that retail space I just mentioned in the distance there. Phase two, which we're currently in sales, is a little bit of a different project for us. It's very different from phase one. Phase one is a black kind of monolithic looking building. Phase two is trying to be a series of mini towers and open up views. And you can see here that the architects are trying to emphasize these individual towers, but really the entire building is serviced by one core. And what it does is there's these large voids in the building that kind of bring natural daylight to the quarters, which is quite a unique feature to condo buildings. You rarely ever see natural daylight in corridors. From those quarters, you can see out both east and west, which is quite interesting. This is a quick diagram the architects did to emphasize that notion. Along the east one, which is where phase two built their townhouses along there. And this is that rooftop shared amenity space I was speaking of. Phase two is similar in size. It's roughly 249 units. Again, that shared amenity space. This space will be more or less 90% built out by the end of phase one. So once phase two is finished, this will be fully operational and accessible by both sides. On the roof of phase two, we have two-story penthouses with private rooftop terraces with amazing views to downtown Toronto. And because of the differences between the two phases, we're trying to link the two architecturally at grade by maintaining this kind of architectural board form concrete, which we're introducing in phase one, and that kind of wraps around phase two, so it kind of ties the two buildings together.
That's it. And just give you some context on the Pan Am Athletes Village. So we thought it would be useful, you've heard from a lot of people today, and Jason. Lester will speak next about Athletes Village and all of the different components of the village project, but we thought it would be a good idea to just explain a bit how everything fits together in the West Valmont. So you've heard just now from Jeff, who discussed River City Phases 1 and 2. The Toronto Community Housing Development that Meg mentioned earlier is the one that you see in orange over here. These are the next two phases of River City Development, which will be coming in the future. Athletes Village is a much larger project, and it comprises all of the blue colors that you see here. I wanted to give you a bit of a breakdown of all of the components, because I think sometimes people don't understand exactly what we're doing before the games, what's happening after, what's temporary, and what is permanent. Just to step back a little bit, I thought it would be good to update you on how we got to where we are today with respect to the Athletes Village project. I think the last time we had one of these larger meetings was probably over a year and a half ago, and there's been a lot of activity in the meantime with respect to this whole transaction. So in October of 2010, Waterfront Toronto, together with the province, Infrastructure Ontario, released a request for qualifications to qualified teams who would be interested in bidding on building and developing the Athletes Village project. In January of the following year, 2011, we released an RFP, which is a very vigorous, approximately six-month process in which three firms were competing. In June of last year, the RFP closed, and we worked very closely with Dundee Kilmer, who was ended up being the preferred proponent. And in January of 2012, we announced that the project had closed, and we were proceeding with Dundee Kilmer as our development partner. So all of the blue stuff here is basically representing the various components of the village that they'll be responsible for. But really, in terms of the permanent construction that's going to be developed as part of the Athletes Village project, it's really the six blocks that you see here. As part of this Athletes Village project, Waterfront Toronto and the province have worked very closely together to make sure that we're implementing the West Don Lands precinct plan and block plan. So all of the permanent development that's taking place as part of the Athletes Village is actually going to be consistent with and implementing our precinct plan and our block plan. In addition to approximately 787 units that Dundee Kilmer will be developing on two of these blocks, we will have 253 units of affordable rental housing that will be used temporarily for the purposes of Athletes Village, housing the athletes. There will be a George Brown College student residence, which is actually going to be their first ever. It'll be 175,000 square feet. It'll eventually house approximately 500 students, and that too will be used temporarily for the purposes of the games in 2015. And we will also be having an 82,000 square foot YMCA, which we're very excited will serve not only the new West Valmont community, but obviously the existing surrounding community. And the YMCA is also going to be used temporarily during the games. It'll be providing a fitness center and sort of training facilities, and then later on it will be sort of returning to normal YMCA purposes. There'll be a pool, a fitness center, and a lot of community space. So the light blue blocks that I've just turned on will be part officially of Athletes Village in 2015, and it's a lot of the area that Dundee Kilmer is working on right now, but they're all going to be temporary facilities. So they're doing a lot of site preparation work in that area right now. When the village is actually in use and when the games are taking place, there'll be temporary things like dining tents and other facilities just for the purposes of the games and for the athletes, but they'll remove all of that and they'll sort of return to the normal course of development after 2015. And then there are three additional blocks of development that Dundee Kilmer will be building out as permanent structures following the games, and if they're needed for any purposes during the games, for the athletes and for the purposes of Toronto 2015, then they'll be used temporarily as part of the boundaries of Athletes Village. So really after the games, this is sort of the landscape of development that we'll be seeing in the West Don Lands based on everything that we've talked about today, and the rest of it will continue in the future. Dundee Kilmer Developments is going to talk to you about the Pan Am Athletes Village and also the Canary District condominiums.
Hello everyone, thank you for joining us tonight.
In our industry, there are a few moments that bring us as much promise and anticipation as being at the forefront of brand new neighborhoods as we are today. 18 months ago, Dundee Realty, together with our partner, Kilmer Van Nostrand, decided to pursue the opportunity to bid on the Pan Am Parapan Athletes Village. Our first decision was to give a call to two of Canada's most distinguished architects, Bruce Couvreur of KPMB, and Peter Clues of Architects Alliance. The ensuing conversations were all about how do you create a successful new neighborhood from a location that has been derelict for the last 20 years. Unlike other Great Toronto neighborhoods that have had decades of ongoing evolution, readaptation, gentrification, this part of the city, as you know too well, had a long pause. KPMB and Architects Alliance, together with our respective development teams, discussed the importance of history, connections to adjacent neighborhoods such as Distillery, Corktown, River City, and St. Lawrence Market, and most importantly, we had discussions on design. Design of not just a single building, but of a community, and from that conversation, it was determined that additional architect firms with their own language of design were retained. It was important for the neighborhood to have a cohesive diversity, a term that Bruce Couvreur often recites in his overall design strategy. The additional firms were Daniel Lestage from Montreal, a recent Canadian gold medalist in architecture, and MJM Architects, Canada's foremost design firm in recreational facilities. We are very honored to have these architects as part of our overall development team. In our RFP bid to Waterfront Toronto and Infrastructure Ontario, we created a short video that illustrates our design strategy of cohesive diversity that I will now play.
Cities. Recent studies show that when people come together in urban areas, they become much more productive. The science is putting math behind J.J. Jacobs' theory of pedestrian-scale neighborhoods facilitating a free flow of information between city dwellers. What we're seeing is that cities help people to meet with these ideas. They call it human friction. The resulting exchange has been proven to increase income, innovation, and even happens by about 15%. The result of all that bumping into one another is that all great cities are a little uncomfortable, but they don't have to be. In fact, the new research suggests the true purpose of urban planning is to find ways to minimize urban stress while maximizing our interactions. City building then is beautiful design and tightly managed resources, but it's so much more. It's about designing conditions to encourage interaction and connection. It's about people, not infrastructure. We have designed a Pan Am Village for people. In the short term, we've designed a community that will quickly attract buyers because of its diversity and value. In the long term, we have designed a community with a lasting vitality that will actually increase innovation for Toronto. We've assembled a team that has all the experience we need to make sure this project happens on time. We've assembled a team with unique experience and learning for a clear head start out of the gates. We have assembled a team that is solid and diverse, that has drawn together a compelling plan that has the chemistry to deliver. We have assembled a team with a clear understanding of the local market and a strategy for rapid sales. The Athletes Village is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for Toronto. It's historic land and part of the city that will play host to people from around the world during the Pan Am and Parapan American Games. It's a place that will easily attract new residents and become home for them once the games are done. And it's a place that will become a model for open living for future generations. We're building a place that people will get on a plane from all around the world to come soon. We're building a place that will be proud to tell our children and grandchildren that they were a part of. We are building Toronto's next great neighborhood.
serving location has kept it on the minds of local residents, city planners, for many decades, and at last, its potential is about to realize. Of course, the history of the area is as old as the land itself. In the 19th century, this was parkland. In the 20th, industrial uses of railway lands. And now, in the 21st century, we are here to help launch a residential and commercial development poised to become Toronto's next great neighborhood. The Canary District, Maine, has a story of its own. Or open a historic building that will stand as a gatepost to the neighborhood. For years, it was home to the Canary Restaurant, a refuge for weary truck drivers, filmmakers, TV crews, and all those who work down here in this authentic, often overlooked pocket of the city. The planning of such a vast, complex project as this is an enormous undertaking. From inside this project, I can tell you that the degree of energy that has gone into it is remarkable. I want to acknowledge the partner, Kevin Van Austin, led by Ken Tannenbaum and Wayne Carson, whose passion and strategic support was invaluable. I also want to thank Waterfront Toronto, Infrastructure Ontario, TO 2015, and many individuals and committees, including the Goodman Ward's Neighborhood Committee and the West Donlands Committee, that were part of the planning process of the precinct plan. So many people, with their tireless enthusiasm, will be represented in the Canary District. From area neighbors and city planners to the engineers, architects, designers, marketing, advertising, public relations, and salespeople, and government officials, this has been a true collaboration of all stakeholders. Just going to walk very quickly through the Canary District in terms of the map here. I'm really going to explain a few things earlier. So some of the highlighted things that are being worked on right now. Just orientate. This is Cherry Street here, north and south, and we're just in the middle of tearing it up, and eventually there'll be a streetcar coming down there. There's an article just on last Friday's Globe talking about the perfect little streetcar tracks that will be laid down by 2015. Even on the far east side is the Don River Park, and then intersecting going east-west is the Front Street Promenade, which last week it's going to be renamed called the Front Street 60-year Jubilee Promenade. YMCA and the George Brown in the top left-hand corner, and the first market buildings at the bottom here. And this not a result. I'll move on to the next slide. The CNR Canary Restaurant buildings, readapted design by Architects Alliance, are the last vestiges of the industrial heritage of the district. These two structures will be refurbished to serve as a western gatepost into the Canary District. We deliberately pushed new construction back from the street corner to let the CNR building breathe and set it within the public plaza to recall the history of the site as a 19th century market square. A transparent pavilion emerges from the building's masonry shell on the east elevation, expressing the connection between the district's past and the future. Blocks 114, designed by Architects Alliance and MJM, unites a new Cherry Street, YMCA, and the 257-unit student residence for George Brown College's new waterfront campus. Lightness and transparency characterize the new Y, which will welcome over 1,000 users a day. Approximately 82,000 square feet. From the dramatic street glass entrance on Cherry Street to the fully glazed gym facing Front Street, the vitality and permeability of the Cherry Street Y identifies the Canary District with health and wellness of individuals, families, and the broader community. The student residence will occupy two 9-story bar buildings arranged along the north and east edges of the block. Elevated above the 2-story Y building, the main entrance will face onto D Street, a quiet residential address that is removed from the busy western gateway. Students can be able to move freely and securely between residential floors via a glazed bridge that connects the two parks. Block 11, designed by KPMG, will create 369 units of market condominiums, townhouses, and a series of narrow bar buildings around the central corridor. Block 11 reflects the high street character of Front and the muscular industrial nature of Mill Street. On streets D and E, a quieter, more residential nature asserts itself in grade-related two-story loft spaces with small porches, front gardens, and terraces. The northwest and southeast corners of Block 11 are lifted to create clear entrances into the block. The elevated courtyard is programmed with residential amenities space on the mezzanine and second floor levels. The design firm of Munch Lung have created interiors and amenity spaces that are solid but engaging, with the same keen attention to materials. Sleek finishes are impeccable, and all the materials in this LEED Gold certified building were sourced locally wherever possible. Block 315, designed by Guido Lestage, will contain 253 units of affordable housing for individuals, couples, and families, in a range of unit types from two-story masonettes at grade to one- and two-story apartment units on upper floors. We made a conscious decision to locate affordable housing in the heart of the district. First, because families are the lifeblood of any Toronto neighborhood, and second, we wanted the housing placed next to the YMCA to give families easy access to wide athletic and community programs. Block 4, designed by KPMB, will provide 436 condominium townhouses and will stand at the eastern gatepost between the district and the Don Valley. The massing has been broken down into tower and slab elements. In essence, two buildings, one addressing Front Street and the other facing Bayview Avenue, with a low-rise lobby pavilion between the two buildings. This gesture allows eastern light to pour into the courtyard and provides panoramic views from the courtyard out to the Don River and the valley behind. The dynamic urban lifestyle that the Canary District will offer is reflected throughout the neighborhood, with an array of unit types that will appeal to busy professionals, growing families, and empty nesters alike, within a lasting community where people want to live, want to work, and want to play. Stylistically, the Canary District is where the industrial character and masonry architecture of the Distillery District meet the scale and texture of Corktown and the edgy identity of River City, a modern but environmental aesthetic geared towards a healthy, vibrant lifestyle that promotes walking and social connection. Now I'm going to turn to the construction schedule. This provides an overview of our schedule where we're putting up these six blocks as well as doing all the municipal works. Last fall, our construction joint venture team led by Alice Long and Lakeward Construction commenced early works on the site, where the team mobilized, commencing deep utility work, excavation, and grading. Having a very mild winter, the construction team was able to continue progress in these areas and began shoring the YMCA and Georgetown residence blocks. 2 weeks ago, we broke ground on the first of two Canary District community buildings that will first house the Parapan American Games athletes. Also last week, the Prince of Wales was on site and introduced to the village and how we are, it was explained to them how we are creating a sustainable new community that is also respectful to the historic past. You never know who your neighbor might be. The construction schedule illustrated above sets out start and completion dates for the municipal works, as well as all of the buildings. Municipal works includes roadworks, as well as hard and soft landscaping of public ground. As you can see, all the buildings are going to be completed by 2014 to facilitate in 2015 the outfit of the events for the athletes themselves, you know, for the Summer Games. This concludes our presentation on the Pan Am Village, and then to Joe from Meg Davis for questions and